Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to be here. Thank you very much to Paul and his team and Tom for putting this day on. And also thank you to the Welcome to Country from you, Lester, and also to the Minister's comments, which are very pertinent. We last were up at Ben Cubbon not so long ago, and I asked you to stop planting trees in blocks, and you did. So thank you very much for that. I'm a biological person. I'm a soil person. Can you hear me out the back? Yep, just you good? All right, thank you. All right, and so I've been in this space for a good 25 years, trying to figure out how soils and biology and microbiology, how all of that stuff all interacts together. And it's great that I've to look out here today and see some people that have been with me for probably 25 years on this journey, trying to understand it as well. And we're getting very close, and yeah, we're going to have a bit of information today, which hopefully will add a bit of scientific light to it all. But also I'm just going to mention that I come from the high production end of Regen Ag. I don't come from the low production end. I want you to have more production so that you can fix more carbon in your system, all right? I want you to be able to run more livestock. And there is ways of running livestock with less methane. So we'll talk some about that. So we'll see how we go for time. All right, Tom, let's have a go at this. The middle one. Okay. So I'd just like to acknowledge some of the people that I've learnt from over the last 25 years. And I'm not going to go through all of them there. The last 3 months, I've been knowing Christine Jones for a very long time, and so I'm going to mention her name quite a bit today, Dr. Christine Jones. She lives in Armidale. She's an ecologist and a microbiologist, and she's dug up some information which is really, really relevant. It's just amazing sometimes how the universe works and everything lines up. So hopefully you're going to see some stuff that you've never seen before. I've been looking for this for 20 years. All right, so thanks to Christine. So I put four topics up there that I want you to have a think about. And prioritise in your mind, okay, straight away, before we even get deeper into this subject. Carbon sequestration was what Tom asked me to talk about, but there are parts to that subject, okay? So one of them is the formation of soil aggregates, atmospheric N2 fixation, and total P, or total phosphorus, not phosphate, okay? It's really important that we think about phosphorus, which is the elemental, the element, not necessarily this water-soluble form. Okay, so when we think about carbon sequestration and regen ag, right, I just want you to prioritise those four things, okay, if you want to do that in your mind. And hopefully by the time I'm finished, you should know which order they should come in, all right? This is a quotation from Professor William Albrecht that I always try to keep in the front of my mind whenever we're out working with clients or studying or researching. Okay, observe nature, read books. If the two don't agree, throw away the books, okay? So I come from a farming background, all right? I also went to Marcus Oldham College. And I also want to acknowledge Marcus Oldham because that college taught me how to think, all right? That's the most important attribute that you can ever have in your entire life is actually learning how to think, all right? So I always like this, and I always try to line those two things up together. Whenever I'm researching science, I want to put it back against the paddock, the farm, whatever, all right? So very, very important. This is a picture of a soil that a client asked me to start working with a long time ago. It produces on a regular basis 8 tonnes of the hectare of barley, all right? And it'll do 4 tonnes of canola and 10 tonnes of hay to the hectare. It's a high-producing soil. He wants his whole farm like that. Anybody in here would like to have that? Okay, I've got one hand. Is that all? Really? One over there? Whoa, good, you people. All right. High production. You can have high production without high inputs. This is not a high-input situation, all right? We'll do another one. This is a soil. This really got me started. This is a soil out of a photograph of an aggregated soil from Austria. The Lubkes people that go and teach people how to compost. And their father, Siegfried Lubke, was actually a genius by Einstein's category. He was seriously smart. We've never heard of him, but he did some amazing stuff. And I'm going to come back to this slide, hopefully, if I can rush through the rest of it. This is another one a bit closer to home out of Kawaramup. We actually have some really good nitrogen fixation going on here. So this was a paddock that had no nitrogen applied to it. And basically, we got some really good production. You can see there, they'll put that in there because of the earthworm, all right? So a really good indicator of how well your farm is doing is whether or not you've got earthworms in there. They're transitional, all right, but they are an important thing. And this is another quick one from when I first started working using compost in soil systems. And went out to this farm and he was putting some urea on. It's an irrigated dairy farm at Harvey. And I just got a soil test back and he had 100 kilos of nitrogen in his soil and he was out spreading urea. And I said, Tony, what are you doing that for? Right? I've just got your soil test. Here it is, 100 kilos to the hectare of nitrogen in your soil. You don't need any. Look at this. You've got aggregates there. They're fixing the nitrogen for you. Stop putting the nitrogen on, got exactly the same production. So it can be done, all right? It can be done. So that's what we're going to talk a bit about today. So how do you make aggregates? All right, so you need to have a carbon polymer made from an extracellular polymeric substance, all right? So I'll go into that a little bit more. But polymers are, think about soil carbon like glad wrap. It's a really good way, so if you've got glad wrap covering all your salt particles, that's what you're looking for. It needs to be recalcitrant. Recalcitrant just means that it can't be broken down. It's really tough material, all right? If your carbon is turning over at a very high rate, then you actually have it. It's not a recalcitrant material. It still hasn't formed all the humic compounds that it needs to form to stop it from turning over, right? Often I hear people say, well, you put carbon in there, but you get a drought or dry year and it's all gone again. Well, it just means that it hasn't been made recalcitrant. It's wrong biology. Need more biology, all right? So broken down, and so it's the enzymes that actually do all that work. Actually, in fact, enzymes do everything in soil. So and the third one is you need to have the right C to N ratio. There's a carbon to phosphorus ratio and a carbon to sulfur ratio. That's all part of it. And you want your carbon to be chemically active, all right? And clay is king, all right? Now, the reason why I say clay is king in terms of making aggregates, it's a lot easier to make a water-stable aggregate, all right, if you have some clay in your system than if you don't. If you've just got pure sand, it's really, really difficult to make stable aggregates. But you've got a bit of clay in there, so I highly recommend to my clients, if they can, just 30, 40 tonne, 50 tonne of clay out there, you can start to make a difference, all right? And then you also hold your nutrients better, you drive your fungi, but Ellen will probably talk a bit more about that. All right, so that's the physical, the biological requirements is that you need to have diazotrophs, so they're the organisms that actually convert atmospheric N2 nitrogen into NH3. You also need lots of other biology that fix nitrogen. So it's just the archaea that fix nitrogen. There's actinium ICDs. So there's lots of other organisms in there other than diatrophs. And you also have to have a thing called quorum sensing. So we're getting a bit technical here, but basically it's the scientific definition, density-dependent coordinator behaviour that regulates gene expression. So how that biology work when they start to communicate with one another, they start to dominate in a particular environment, because you've got to remember that biology can communicate with one another, plants communicate with biology. So there's a whole city going on under that ground, and it's very complex, all right? As the minister said, it's not simple to get your head around it. So quorum sensing has been around probably since the 1960s in biological terms. It's not a new thing. But quorum sensing in terms of fixing nitrogen or fixing carbon is something that we haven't done a lot with, but it's an important part of the whole system. You also need a low oxygen environment because oxygen destroys the nitrogenase enzyme, and that's pretty important. All right, so your extracellular polymeric substances, this is a photo that came from Patricia Holden. She's a researcher in California. And I always like this because it just gives you something, that glad wrap thing that I was talking about. How does carbon actually fit in soil? So this is Pseudomonas, which is a very common, Regenosis, which is a very common bacteria, makes a slime, all right? And that slime basically covers all your material, all right? So that's the bit that's important in this, okay? It's and then you've got another, you can actually see those organisms there. So they protect themselves. If you've got an infection with Pseudomonas, it's basically antibiotic resistant because that slime protects them from what they're doing. Also holds moisture. It's how they keep themselves alive over summer. So you think the soil's completely dry? No, it's not. There are extracellular polymeric substances there that actually enable them to stay alive. Now, this is one of the most important slides, all right? And it looks, so you look at that and you sort of go straight over the top. But, all right, I'm just going to have to point here, okay?
All of these little hexagons along the bottom, right, represent, right, different carbon structures. So out here on the end, you might have a quinone, you might have a phenolic structure in there. Down here, you've got a peptide, all right? So all of this actually makes up your glad wrap. All right, you got that? You can nod. It's okay, all right? But what's important in all of this is that that is bonded to your clay mineral, all right? And that bond is actually stronger than the clay when it bonds to one another because this thing's got charge. It's got a charge. This polymer's got a charge, okay? And when you put another layer on top of there, the bond between the two polymers is less than what the bond is between the clay. That's why I said clay is king. If you want to fix a lot of carbon in your soil, adding some clay, right, is an important part of the process. You got that? All happy with that? Now, the next part is atmospheric nitrogen. Because you need to have the nitrogenase enzyme, all right, to get that carbon to nitrogen ratio that we're talking about. And the nitrogenase enzyme is known as a metalloenzyme, all right? So it needs molybdenum, but it also needs iron as a cofactor to donate the electrons, all right? This is one of the most important equations that you'll ever see, all right? Good. We're getting a bit of response there. Clear as mud. Okay, you're all good with that? Now, when we talk about fixing nitrogen, this is the bit that makes it really tricky, all right? We're going to go over here again. So that's N2, right? So this is atmospheric nitrogen, two N's bonded together with a triple bond. Very, very difficult to split that apart. You need 8 electrons that come from the iron. You need 8 protons which come from your water. Then you need 16 units of ATP energy, adenosine triphosphate. That is a lot of energy, but it's driven by phosphorus, okay? So you need to have a lot of phosphorus in your system before you're going to end up with NH3, right? So the protons come down there, 2 waters, 16 ADP, which is adenosine diphosphate, and 16 P ions, right? Which eventually will come back around and go back into ATP again, all right? But if you've got a low level of phosphorus in your system, all right, you're going to struggle to get this reaction to happen, all right? So now your total P becomes a really important part, okay? Because if you've got phosphatase enzymes, which is the plant will produce the phosphatase enzymes, they actually have to have access to some phosphate somewhere, right? So it's a bit like, you know, in terms of this reaction, phosphate needs to be like this. It needs to be everywhere, right? You don't want to be, I think there's one over there, and I think there's another one over there. That is never going to work. Never going to work, all right? And it doesn't, all right? So your total P is really, really critical. Oh, mate. Right, we're going to put it up a gear, people. Sorry. It's going to go up a gear. How many people have heard of the Jena experiment? No one? Got one out the back. This is one of the most groundbreaking pieces of research I've ever come across. And the reason why, right, is because it's all about, multi-species, all right? It's a pasture experiment. And the reason why it's important is because they also set up a multifactorial part to it. There are 500 plots in this experiment in Germany. They've done 80,000 measurements. It's all about regen ag, all right, and understanding how the system works. What they discovered, and I started jumping around when I saw this, okay, because I've been looking for this for 20 years, all right? 200 kilos of nitrogen, all right, did not produce more grass. This is a grass experiment, did not produce more grass than 4 families of plants and 16 species. That's 435 kilos of urea, people, did not grow more grass. Okay? And it proves conclusively that we can actually sequester nitrogen. You just got to know how to do it, all right? We've got to think differently, all right, and we can sequester that nitrogen. And this is the next important graph. Can you see that graph? Good? Anybody see that? This is really important that you see this, all right? I'd like this screen to be twice as big next time, Tom. All right? You got that? Okay. Oh, it's hard to see, right? Okay. Along the bottom, we have plant families and plant species going from 1 to 16, okay? Up the top, we have dry matter production going from 100 to 700, okay? So as the number of plant families and the number of species increase, the production, dry matter, goes up in a straight line curve. Sorry, straight line, not a curve. Always these things go in a curve, right? They go up, right? This is really important stuff, right? You get it? Because where's the end? Where's it going to flatten? All right, we've got the 7 tonne. Why can't we get to 12? No fertilizer here, people. 7 tonnes of hectare dry matter, no fertilizer. All right? This is seriously groundbreaking stuff, okay? Now, I'm going to have to flat it, put the pedal down. So multi-species is really important. So here you've got a little trial done in California. That's monoculture versus the same species, the same plants, as a multi-species there, right? Monocultures versus biodiversity. Okay?
Monocultures don't work. This is a multi-species crop from out at Lake King. I'm going to have to keep flying here a little bit. Now, that's my brain. No, it's not. But it could be, all right? Whenever I look at this, I thought, well, I wonder whether humus is actually the brains in the soil, okay? It could well be. We'll wait and see. This is another photograph of some compost. And once again, you look really carefully there, you can actually see those mini aggregates there, all right? These are micro aggregates. Whenever we get this, the compost works and you get nitrogen fixation happening. This is a photograph of humic acid. You're all familiar with, if you're in this space, you should be familiar with humic acid. When they photograph with a scanning electron microscope, you find aggregates again, and the aggregates are 500 nanometers, which is half a micron in diameter, 200 times smaller than a human hair, but it's still an aggregate, all right? Everything based on aggregates. So this is some compost from... you can see that, right? We'll go to the next one. There's one, I'll flick through all of this because there's one thing that I really want to do. That's actually a fungus sequestering carbon into soil through a fungal transfer, but that's not what I want to get to. And that's a wheat crop that's going 6.5 tonne to the hectare with no fertiliser. You can talk to me about that later. All right. This is a soil that went from 2.5% organic matter, which is 1.4 carbon, to 16.8 in 5 years, went from 100 mil deep to 900 mil deep in 5 years, all right? That's not supposed to happen. Can't do it. Condensed tannins, we're not going to talk about them. Now, if you've got a soil carbon project, this is what I want to talk about. I'm finishing up right now, mate. If you're interested in soil carbon and sequestering, right, this is some really important numbers here for you. So if you take a top metre of soil, you end up with 13,000 tonnes of soil at 0.1% increase equals 13 tonnes of carbon per annum, all right, over the top metre of soil. The minister just mentioned 0.4. We're just working here on 0.1. After 10 years, you've sequestered 130 tonnes of carbon in your soil. Now, if you want to cost that out, an ACU, which is a carbon CO2 equivalent, carbon dioxide equivalent, one tonne of soil carbon is equal to 3.67 carbon units. So one ACU is worth, at the present moment, $40 at exactly this time of the year. Last year, when I started on some carbon projects, it was $16. Today, it's $40. In Europe, it's $100. In America, it's $80. And New Zealand, it's $50. Right? This thing's just going off. It's going up. You need to look at it very seriously. If you want to do those sums, you come up with $20,000 per hectare over a 10-year period. All right? If you've got a 1,000-hectare farm, you've got a telephone number sitting there for superannuation. All right? Now, Jennifer West is here with Sam Hewitt. Where are you, please, Jennifer? Down the back. Those two guys, turn around, look at them. Toby from Carbon Farming Foundation is here. Toby's down the back. Talk to these guys. These will be. Don't talk to me about this. Talk to them. All right, we'll leave it at that. Thanks, Paul.